Goed zo, mijn naam is Walter Belgers en as you can see I'm quite old. I started soldering a long time ago in 1978 and I've also started programming in 1978 on this computer. I actually have the same computer that I started on in 1978, an XD Sorcerer computer. And I like computers. I have a whole collection at home of old computers from some microsystems, but I had all kinds of computers. And I also like being in Russia because I know that in countries like Russia, it was really hard in those days to get hold of a computer. And there were many more people that had to build something themselves or adapt existing computers. Whereas where I'm from, you just bought it or got it or your father got one from work and that was it. But I think over here, there's much more people really playing with computer systems. And this talk is about what we call Gigatron, a TTL computer. And this was the first version of it on a breadboard. And actually a friend of mine, Marcel, he started out with building this. There you see Marcel on the picture. And together we've built it into a kit. And the idea was, what if you start with very simple TTL chips? Or over here you have the famous 155 series. If you have these simple chips that do almost nothing, like NAND or NOR, or maybe a multiplexer, or a combination of NORs and NANDs, what can you build out of those components? So if we now take a lot of stuff from the late 1970s, early 1980s, what could you build with that these days? And the idea was to build a home computer or a CPU, a central processing unit. And there's actually a whole bunch of people on the internet doing this. And there's a homebrew CPU ring, and you will find many websites of people playing around with hardware, building a CPU. Right? So you can buy a CPU ready-made. So that's the famous MOS 6502 processor that you will find in the Apple One. This is an Apple One computer, also from the end of the 1970s. And you will find it in the Commodore 64. But this is quite a complex chip. There's the diagram of what's in there. So there's it can do arithmetic, and there's registers and stack pointers and program counters. But we wanted no CPU. We wanted just the TTL logic. So a CPU, we are going to build the microprocessor out of these very simple things. So the idea was we are using the 7400 series of TTL logic. Why? Because they are very simple chips, but also because you can still buy them. They are quite old, but you can just still get them. And also the old versions with which you solder through hole inside of a circuit board. So we didn't want
to use it for brand new.
Brand new. Yeah. They are still being produced. We did not want any complex chips with a lot of stuff in there, so no CPU, but also no ALU. So that's the arithmetic logic unit. So this can do calculations, and as you can see, this is quite a big chip. Also, I don't think they are produced anymore. But we didn't want this. We want to build this from smaller components. We want it to be a simple single board computer. So if you look in this at this web ring, you will see that some people build their computer out of multiple boards. But we wanted just one board to keep it simple. And we wanted only to have maybe 30 or 40 chips on there. The idea was also to make an 8-bit system, just like the Apple or the Commodore. Have a bit of a retro look. It should look a bit old, but it's not very hard with those old components. And it needed to be somewhat useful. So in the beginning, we thought we would have a few buttons and maybe a few LEDs. But during the design, we found out we could do more with the chips. And we aimed for simple games. And maybe a clock application, because if you have such a neat box, you don't want to store it in a cupboard, but you want to have it on display. So it must do something useful. So the idea was if we have this thing make a clock on the screen, you can have it on all day. We also wanted it to be educational, so you can learn how computers work from building it and using it. And of course, it should be fun. So those were the design goals. Simple system with just a few components. But the design goals are not set in stone. So if we come across a problem and we need to do something, well, we can tweak it a little bit. So we have, for instance, tweaked it a bit. We have included micro USB connector. So of course that's cheating, because in end of 1970s there was no USB. But we only use it to power the device. So that for us that's okay. It's only for 5 volts. And we use a high-speed, low-power version of these chips that were not available in the 1970s. Now they are, and that means this whole system will use only a few hundred milliamps. But you can still put in the original chips from the 70s, and it will still work. It will use a lot more power, but if we build it for the kit, we use the newer version. We wanted to keep the hardware as simple as possible. And that will, I will repeat that a couple of times during my talk. When you can solve something that we need to do with the computer in software, that's what we would do. Because it's easy to write something in software, and it's hard to change the hardware design. And actually, this computer is super simple, and still it can do a lot because of all the software in there. And we started simple and just went with it and saw where we could get. Now, a little bit of background about computers. So a computer, the green block, that's the central processing unit, the CPU, the microprocessor. But we don't have a microprocessor. We have to build this all ourselves. And in it is something that can do calculations. There is a control unit that determines what is going on in a computer. And there's some memory. Then we have internal memory, external memory, like disks, floppies, hard drives. And we have some input and some output. Now, the external memory, disks and stuff, we said that's just too complicated. We are not going to use any, there's no SD card, maybe in the future, but now there's no SD card, there's no hard drive connected. That's too complicated. For the internal memory, we use two chips. The chip on the left is an EEPROM. It looks really old. It's nice. So this is a chip that you can erase by using UV light, and you can reprogram it. So that has the program in it. And we have a RAM chip. And now the first design question is, how do we run the program? And how do we get the program to do something with the RAM? And in the 1940s, the computers had the Harvard design, which is not used anymore, actually. And in the 40s came a guy called John von Neumann. And he wrote a famous paper together with a few colleagues about his new design. And his new design meant that program and data is in the same memory location. And that is what, if you take your phone or your laptop, it all uses von Neumann. This means that you can put a program somewhere in memory and just start running it. Now, that was revolutionary at the time, because before that, you had, as I said, Harvard. And in Harvard, you have program memory, stores the program, and you have data memory, where you can put stuff in and read it out. But you cannot put a program in data memory. Actually, that's very secure, but it's really cumbersome. It's really hard to program. So that was an example of the first time that we had to make a decision. What are we going to do? Are we going to make a modern computer using the von Neumann architecture that would be easy to program, but it is more complicated in hardware? So our goal was keep hardware as simple as possible. So we chose the Harvard architecture. So the hardware is really simple, but now programming is more of a problem. Right, so this is the same picture, but in a different way. We see again the control unit, arithmetic, I/O, program memory, data memory. We have these two chips doing that. And the program can, in our computer, only be stored in the EEPROM. Now, how does the computer run a program? Well, the program is a set of instructions, and it needs to read out instructions and do something. Now, the instructions, of course, are in order, so there is a program counter pointing at where in the memory you are currently looking. And you can step through the memory and run the program. So this is the board as it is here. And here you see all the components, and I will highlight them throughout my talk. So here, for instance, is the program counter. So we use four chips, and it's just a counter. And they count, it keeps track of where you are within the program. And this is needed. This is the clock circuit. This just increments the counter every clock tick. And here we have the ROM that contains the program to be run. So there's only a few components. And then we have some more stuff, but it's only for the 5 volts or the 5 volts that we need. So we have some protective circuitry in case you have a short circuit. So it runs on USB power. Right, so we have a program counter and the program ROM. And as I said, the program counter points somewhere in the ROM, and out come the instructions. So an instruction is just a byte. In our case, because we have an 8-bit computer, we have 8-bit instructions. So this thing means something. It is an instruction, and the question is, what do these instructions do? And this is really nice. If you build a computer with a microprocessor, the instructions are already in the microprocessor. So if you buy a 6502, you have the 6502 instructions, and if you buy a Z80, you have the Z80 instructions. But since we are designing our systems, the system ourselves, it is up to us to decide what these instructions are doing. And here we had another design choice. There's two types of computers. There's computers that use RISC and use CISC. So with RISC, you have the reduced instruction set. You have only a few instructions, and they are very simple. So you need a lot of them to do something. And you have CISC, complex instruction set. And there the instructions do something very complicated. But that's really complicated in hardware, because a CISC instruction does a couple of things. Each instruction can do more things. So you give an instruction to the processor, and it needs to go through a loop and do several things. Well, that's way too complicated for us. We are just going to use RISC. So if we have one instruction, it does one simple thing, done. And that makes programming a bit more difficult. But we said, well, that's fine. Easy hardware, difficult to program, fine. Now, you can have instructions that tell you to store something in memory or increment a counter, but you also want to give operands. So if you have an instruction to store something in memory, you also want to point where in memory you want to store it. That's the operand. Or if you want to add something, you want to tell the system how much to add. The operand. So, and we have decided that each instruction of 8 bits has one fixed operand of also 8 bits. So you have, this might be the instruction, put something in memory, and this then points to where in memory that needs to happen. Sometimes the operand is not used at all. If I have an instruction that says you need to increment something with one, and that's just the instruction, we don't need the operand. But to make hardware simple, in our program ROM, each instruction comes with one operand, always. And we cheated a little bit. We used an EEPROM that does not output 8 bits at a time, but 16 bits. So the first 8 is the instruction, and the last 8 is the operand. And that is being stored here. So each clock cycle, 16 bits come out, 8 bits are the instruction, and 8 bits are the operand.
And program counter is also 16 bits?
Yes. So let's dive into the instruction. So it was really cool. Yes, of course. I will show you the instructions later, but it's all very limited. So you cannot say I have two registers, and we also have very few registers. But I will go into that. So the cool thing about designing your own computer and your own processor is that we get to decide what happens with these instructions, as I said. And so the instruction is like the controller. It controls who has access to what kind of operation, what kind of arithmetic I'm doing, what happens to the program counter, what happens to registers. And it's up to us to decide what it's going to do. And in the end, this came out. And this is a piece of hardware. And in Go, the 8 bits of the instruction, and then some magic happens, and out come 19 signals that make sure that the right thing happens in the system. So we decided what kind of instructions it would be able to do. And we decided that we would use 2 bits to determine who has access to the bus. I'll explain in a minute. We reserved 3 bits for the address mode, and it's also used in jumps, and 3 bits for the actual instruction. Now let's have a look. So the bus access means we have things in here like RAM, ROM, input, output, and they need to talk to each other. You do that over the bus, but not everything can talk at the same time. So we need to control who can talk to each other. So 00 means the operand, which comes out of the program ROM, is sent to the bus. We can send the RAM to the bus. We can send the accumulator, which is a register, or the input to the bus. Then we have the instruction. So this is what it can do. It can store something, load. It can do an AND, an OR, XOR, an ADD, a subtract, a store into memory, or it can do a jump. And that's everything there is. That's not much. If the instruction is one of these 6, then the middle 3 bits are the address mode, and they determine where we are going to store. I'll show you. This is the arithmetic unit, the ALU. So this can do computations. It always does a computation with the accumulator and the bus. Nothing else is possible. So this is a register with a value, and this value can come from different sources. It does some sort of calculation, and then we have a result. Now it's interesting that traditionally, out of the ALU also comes a lot of status. So if you do an addition, you say, I want to add this with this, it will automatically tell you if it was a positive number, the outcome, or a negative number, or if it was 0, or if you have a carry. But for us, that was too complicated. The only thing that comes out of here is a carry. So if you do an addition and it doesn't fit in 8 bits, you get a carry flag, and that's the only flag we have. If you want to know if the result was 0, you need to write some program code to check it out. If you do one of these calculations, then the middle 3 bits are the address mode, and they determine 2 things. They determine where the RAM pointer is pointing to, and where the result of the computation goes to. So let's make it clear using the example on the left. You see there 01010100, that's a valid instruction. So the first two bits, 01, they mean the RAM value goes to the bus. So we are going to take something from the RAM and put it here. Then these 3 bits mean, well, the RAM address we are going to read from is the location YD. So Y is also a register, and D is the operand. So this points to where we are going to read from the RAM. And we also determine that the result goes back into the accumulator. And the instruction was add, so we're going to tell the ALU to do an addition. So it looks quite complicated, but with a few instructions, we can now do calculations on memory addresses or on input and write it to the accumulator or write it into a register or to the output. And as you can see, we don't have many registers. We have an X and Y and the accumulator.
And the RAM value accumulate with the accumulator.
Yes, the ALU always uses the accumulator together with something else.
Question.
Yeah.
So this current instruction is essentially take something from the address and add it to the accumulator.
Yeah, it takes something from that address.
Something else comes
that's
out,
it.
It's just kind of like
puts it back in.
Yeah.
Yeah. So we had something. Yeah. We take something from RAM, add it, put it back. Done.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And how is different to the classic models?
It is kind of the same as classic models, but this is very simple. So we only have a few operands, and we have only very few registers. So with a normal CPU, you have many more registers. And you can also use 16-bit registers, and we don't have any of that. So that means you need to do a lot more programming. So in a normal computer, you can store anything, any result in any register, and do all kinds of operation between registers. But for us, you constantly have to move it to the accumulator, do stuff, and move it back. Yeah.
And for example, in the IRM processor, in the load instruction, ALU used to calculate an address. It can calculate some offset to address, but this is impossible.
You can use the registers to point to a certain value, as we do here. So this the Y register is used here to determine where in the RAM you are looking, but you cannot do any calculations on that in the meantime.
Not in a single. Not in a single.
Right. So here you see this decoder. So as I said, the instruction has 8 bits, and out come all these signals that do something, that tell the ALU what to do and what to do put on the bus. So that's the thing that controls the whole system. And that you can see here on the board, and actually you see these diodes, you can actually see that it is kind of a ROM. So if this signal is high, it does something there. And you can actually trace on the circuit board exactly how that works. And if you wanted to, you could change the instruction set just by changing these diodes. Actually, there's one guy who bought a Gigatron of us, and he's really into chess computers. And he hasn't done it yet, but he wanted to change the instruction set to make it easier to play chess on it. So if you want to, you can. The last two I haven't talked about yet. So we have also a store instruction. If you use the store instruction, the bus goes to the RAM. That's the only instruction we have to put something in the RAM. And we have a branch instruction, so that's a jump. And we have 8 types of jump, depending on the accumulator. And this is actually quite interesting, and I could talk 50 minutes about just how this works in hardware. Because as I said, we only have the carry flag, so we don't have a flag to see if it is 0. But we were still able, with some clever hacking, to make the hardware such that we could do this. So we have these kinds of jumps, and we also have a far jump that I may explain as well, but maybe not. Let's see. So that's the ALU. So that's the thing that does the arithmetic. So we have one of these chips per bit. 8 chips, 8 bits. Let's talk about output and input. So to control something, you can use out here, and then the accumulator goes to the output port, depending on what is connected to the output port. And for input, you can use input goes to the bus, and you can use many combinations of instructions to do something with the input. So let's talk about the input and output. The output was originally designed to be an LED matrix. So when the project started, we thought we can make something that plays a simple tic-tac-toe game on this thing. And then somebody had a YouTube video about the Quark 85, which is a very tiny microprocessor, an 80 tiny. And this person was able to generate VGA output using this 80 tiny. So this is actually sending the raw VGA signal to the screen, calculating it live. And then we thought, wow. So you can do, with quite simple electronics, you can do VGA output. Couldn't we build VGA into the Gigatron? That would be much cooler than the LED matrix. And actually, VGA is not as difficult as you might think. It's quite easy to do. At least if you take the simplest form of VGA, that's 640 times 480. And what you do is you just output the color bits, but you also need to send synchronization signals. So after every line on the screen, you have to send a horizontal sync pulse. So the monitor knows it needs to go to the second line. And after you've done a full screen, you need to send a vertical sync pulse, so the monitor knows that a new screen is starting. So that is what we needed to add to our computer. We need to send horizontal and vertical sync pulses to be able to make VGA signal. And the timing is quite critical. If you want to make VGA, the timing must be right. But we are using RISC architecture, right? So every instruction takes one clock tick. So we know exactly, it's very easy to calculate how long it takes to do a piece of program. So we decided to let the Gigatron run on 6.25 megahertz, which is a quarter of the speed of VGA. And that is also the fact why the X register in the system is a counter, because that makes it easy. So what we do is we take values from the RAM and we put them onto the screen. And the Gigatron is just fast enough to do that, and only that, at a quarter of the speed of VGA. So that just means that every 4 pixels, the pixel changes. So we have the quarter of the resolution. And that's also the reason why the X register is a counter, because we need to send the pixel to the screen and increment the counter. And if that would take 2 instructions, it would take 2 clock cycles. So we made the X register a counter, so we have an instruction that we can say the RAM needs to go to the screen and increment X. And then the next instruction, the next value goes to the screen and we increment. Next. Next.
So you have
a misaligned
video.
Yeah, I'll explain.
Okay. Oh, and sorry, I'm not familiar enough with video protocols, but as I know, the VGA is analog and there's many digital.
This is analog, this is the old VGA.
And protocols like HDMI need much more.
HDMI, much too complicated. And this is also, this is a bit cheating, because VGA did not exist in the late 70s. But we thought, well, you know, this is...
Yeah, but it's very similar to TV protocol, because basically this is very, very close to Atari console 2600. Like, you just missing chips, which need to, like, put colors, and that's it.
Yeah, we didn't want a separate modulator thing in there. So we're quite happy with VGA. This is the simplest form of VGA. It's just analog. And the screen is like this. What you see on the actual monitor is just part of the whole screen. So you write the lines all the way to the back, but the last piece is not shown on your TV set. And also the last lines are not shown. Right, so you write the pixels, then you do the sync, and then you have some time. So that's time. In the old days, this was needed for analog monitors to send the beam to the next line. And then you can do new pixels, and then you have a bit of time, new pixels, etc. at the end. And on here, you send a vertical sync, and you also have some time in which nothing is displayed. So
this time is needed.
Yeah, to get the beam back up to the first line. So in digital monitors, that's still in the, it's in the protocol, so it's still being used. So timing is very critical for VGA. If your timing is a bit off, the monitor, modern monitors will stop showing the picture. But timing is easy for us because we have RISC. Every instruction is one clock tick. But it's really hard to make a program, to program in machine language and to get all the timings right. So one of the first things was, this was solved by, in the very beginning, creating a software interpreter. So that's a piece of software in the ROM. And that will do all the writing to screen. So it will write pixels. And here, it will send the horizontal sync. And it will look to see if there is anything else it needs to do. And you can put code in the ROM. And this interpreter will take the code and look, this instruction is taking 5 clock ticks, or this piece takes 5 clock ticks. We have time for that. Let's do it. It gets back. Oh, there's another instruction, also 5 clock ticks. Yeah, fits in, does it. Next instruction. Oh, we don't have any time. I'm going to do the next scan line. So this is done in software. So there is a interpreter running that takes at every scan line a bit of the code that we have written to see if it can be executed. And with that, VGA was, in hardware, super simple. It's just sending out the data out of the VGA plug. So we have a few resistors as a simple digital analog converter. And that goes to the screen with the H-sync and the V-sync. And that's nicely 8 bits. So that's good. So because the speed of the computer, we only change the pixel every, the color every 4 pixels. So horizontal, we only have 1/4 of the resolution. And vertical, we have a problem that a whole screen is bigger than the RAM. We have 32K of RAM, and it doesn't hold a complete screen. So what we do is we repeat the same line 4 times. So then we only need 1/4 of the RAM, and it fits. And then, so then all the pixels are actually 4 times as big as normal. Right? So the resolution is 4 times as small horizontally and 4 times as small vertically. Effective resolution 160 by 120. And there's that line. We said, well, you know, if we repeat the same line 3 times instead of 4, then we have one line that we can keep black. And during that one line, we have time to do actual stuff. Because otherwise, we only have a little bit left for our real program, and the rest of the time is only VGA. But if we have this extra line, then we see we have more, we can do more computations. And in the later ROMs, you can actually switch between 1, 2, or 3 of these lines. I'll take a break in a bit, but first this. So this was one of the first test pictures that we got out of there. So this is 160 by 120 VGA. And the hardware is only this. We have an output register to store the byte, and the 8 resistors, and a VGA plug. That's it. Now, can we do more output? We had this. We were already very happy that we could do VGA. But of course, you want more. So can we do more without putting in much more hardware? Well, you know, we thought we have these sync pulses. So every scan line, there's a sync pulse. And during the sync pulse, we don't need any screen output. So could we maybe redirect the output to some other device? Maybe sound. Sure. So during each horizontal sync pulse, that one byte doesn't go to the screen, but goes to 4 LEDs. And the speaker output. So we can change the status of the LEDs every scan line once, but that's fast enough. And we get this actually for free. We already had the hardware. So with the same hardware, we can also do 4 blinking lights and audio. Well, we need one chip to store the stuff. And there is the output connectors. Yeah.
But if we draw a picture, we will see here.
Now, what happens is that if there is no pulse, the output goes to VGA. And when there is a pulse, the output is redirected, not to the screen, but to the audio and the LEDs. And what happens is then during that pulse, it's stored in the chip, and then it's there until the next scan line. And we needed input, because now we thought, now we have enough stuff in there to play games, so we wanted to play games. Yes?
Why you make it software only rendering? Making hardware for this purpose, not difficult.
Special purpose hardware. Well, actually, this is mainly a VGA card with a bit of computing power in there. If I don't know how else I could easily make it without using maybe a microprocessor or an ATtiny or something.
I just seen one guy make a video card from two ROM chips, one for store image, another for combination logic, and counter.
Yeah, but we want to have, but that's static output, and we want to have dynamic output. So in those solutions, you would end up with actually two processors, one doing the video part, and one doing the computing part. And we have integrated it. We have built a thing that does mainly VGA card stuff, and in a small percentage of the time, it can also do games. So the games, we wanted to have a simple controller. So we found the old Famicom controller, also known as the NES controller, and that normally has a really weird plug, but there's also versions that have a DB9 plug, which is much more easy to find. So we use that one. It does contain some electronics, so we had to reverse engineer the controller. And what happens is that you need to send it a pulse, and then to start pulling it, and then you send a second pulse, and every time you send a pulse, out comes one bit, one for each of the buttons. So I thought, oh no, we need more output, because now we need to send signals to the controller to start reading out what buttons are pushed. Hey, wait a minute, we already have output with those H-sync and V-sync signals. Let's just take this wire from the V-sync and send it to the controller to start pulling. And take the wire from the horizontal sync and send it to the controller to start reading out the bits. And that works. So every time a new screen starts, it sends the signal to read out the controller. And then after every line, it reads one bit from one of the buttons. So in software, we need to make sure that we wait until 8 lines have been displayed, and then we can read out the contents of the controller. And the only thing we need for that is one chip to hold that input.
So in milliseconds, how much is delay?
Oh, not noticeable. So, what have we got? We have a CPU, and there is no ready-made microprocessor like 6502. We build it all out of simple stuff. It's a RISC computer. Simple instructions. One instruction does one thing. It runs at 6.25 megahertz because of the VGA timing. We have 32K of RAM, which is needed to store a few images and games. We have VGA output, we have sound output, we have blinking lights, we have controller input, and we have this piece of software, the interpreter, that makes sure that we do not have to worry about the timing at all. I would like to talk a little bit about the software, because the software is doing a lot. I would like to talk a little bit about how we made it into a kit and what you need to do so. And of course, I can do some demonstrations.
May I ask a question?
Yes, of course.
What is the power consumption from USB?
About 300 milliamps. Is that right? Yeah.
So you can run it from the battery all day?
Yeah. Although if you put in the original chips, it is about 1 amp.
You need to make a mobile version?
Yeah, well, you can.
Does it get toasty in the original chips?
Does it get?
Toasty.
Toasty, yes, it gets toasty. I have I have thermal images, and you can see it gets really hot. No, well, modern versions of the original. No, they don't make them anymore, right? So no, those are original chips. We tried to build one with the oldest chips we could still find, and that really became hot. So the interpreter is really important because the interpreter does all the timing for the VGA signal. It emulates a virtual PC. So we write not in machine code for this computer, but we write in an language we have invented ourselves, which we call GCL, the Gigaton Command Language. So in this language, we have something we call vCPU instructions, virtual CPU instructions. And so the interpreter is running from the ROM, because we can only run software from ROM. And it reads the RAM to see if there are any virtual instructions, and it then interprets them and executes them. So now we can actually have program code, interpreted program code in the RAM. And the program code is actually 16-bit. So the interpreter understands 16-bit virtual code and translates it into the 8-bit code of the Gigaton. And that looks a bit like Sweet 16. That was a language designed by Steve Jobs on the Apple I, because the Apple I is also 8-bit. And he wanted to do 16-bit stuff, so he built Sweet 16. And that's a language, and you can program in it, and it will be emulated on a 8-bit Apple I. So the result of our work is that we have if you look at it from the software, we have a 16-bit machine with a Von Neumann architecture. But the hardware is actually 8-bit Harvard. So in the EEPROM, we have the main program, we have maybe an image, and we can have multiple applications written in this higher level language. And the main program will take the screen data and put it on the screen. That's what it's doing most of the time, reading RAM and just outputting it. But as you remembered, these edges, we have time to do something else. So in that time, so what it will do is it will load a virtual CPU application into the RAM and execute that. So this is the main video loop, and this application is now also in RAM, and it's being executed or emulated and executed by our interpreter. This was one of the first programs that we built, and you can see it's also scrolling. That's actually quite easy to do. The way the memory is built up, we have a pointer pointing to the beginning of each line. So by changing the pointer, it's really easy to do horizontal scrolls. Of course, we made that to make it easier to make games. And there's also people who have started building emulators. There's now, I believe, 3 different emulators. And it can completely emulate the system. This is the one of the oldest ROMs. And here you can see it do the game that you've seen in real life. So it's still quite slow to build the screen.
Sorry.
Yeah.
Did you get the idea for startup chime from Temple
OS? Actually, Marcel built a startup chime. I don't know if it was inspired by something, but at that time we weren't really into looking in the audio capabilities, so we built just something that did something, and it stayed in there all of the time. So we built these games, and the performance is actually quite well, given the fact that most of the time it's doing VGA. So this was the first PCB that we made. It was about 1500 hours of work for 2 people. And of that, about 30% is maybe in the design, and 70% is in making it into a kit, writing the software, and doing all of that. So sometimes people on the internet think, you can just build something on your breadboard, and then you have a nice new computer. True, and it's really fun to do, build your own thing on a breadboard. But if you want to make it into a product and make a kit out of it, Yeah, that requires a lot more work, but still it's fun to do. So let's dive into the process of making it into a kit. So this was the first prototype PCB that we designed, and we spent quite a lot of work in that. It took about 10 weeks of development, also because we had no experience in building a PCB. And we wanted it to look really retro, so we have really thick tracks. And we wanted the layout to be nice, so you can really see how the computer is working. And we want to explain everything, so there's a lot of text, and also to make it easier to compile the kit and not make mistakes, like putting the chip wrong way around. And the first PCB had only a few mistakes, and it worked. So that was really nice. Here it's showing the breadboard version of itself. So we made it into a kit. And that meant we needed to find a supplier for the wooden cases. We needed the PCBs to be built, score parts, but also write the manual. And we were lucky. I come from Eindhoven, and in Eindhoven there's also two guys I know quite well who run the cryptomuseum.nl or .com maybe. They collect crypto machines like Enigma. And they also have made an electronic kit version of the Enigma machine. And they've been selling it for years. And they said, if you want to make it into a kit for people to build it themselves, you need to make sure that the manual is really, really well. So it's easy for people to build, and they don't ask you a lot of questions about stuff that doesn't work. So we spent a lot of time beforehand putting everything that we could think about into the manual to prevent people from having trouble making it.
It's not usual for DIY projects, but the manual.
No. And it actually contains a chapter on how to insert the components and how to do soldering and how all the electronic components work. Maybe if you looked into it. Just to make it easier. And actually, there have been people for whom this was the first time they soldered. And I would not recommend doing a thing as complicated as this as this for your first soldering project. But those people were actually able to do so. So that's quite nice. So the kit consists of the PCB, the chips, and a bag of components, controller, manual. And it takes about 3 to 4 hours to put together, soldering. It costs about half of that putting it together. So that's something that actually is quite shocking, how much time it takes to build these kits. Because these bags, there's plenty of components, so I need to pick them all up one by one, put them in the bag, and put the chips one by one from the tubes and onto the foam, and program all the ROMs, and et cetera, et cetera. And of course, you need a little bit of marketing, so we sent a kit to, this is the 8-bit guy, yeah, to the 8-bit guy. And we said, well, let's give the 8-bit guy one of these kits, and I think he'll enjoy it, although he's not somebody who likes to solder. He's really, he likes to use old computers, 8-bit computers. And we thought, he's going to tell us that he misses BASIC, because we know that this guy likes to program in BASIC, and we don't have any BASIC. In fact, we don't have a keyboard. We cannot, there's no SD card. The stuff is in the EEPROM, and that's what you get. Of course, you can reprogram the EEPROM, but not anybody, everybody has an EEPROM eraser and programmer at home. And that's exactly what he said. He liked it very much, but he missed the BASIC. We also sent it to Dave Jones from EEV Blog. Now, he's really a guy into soldering and less into computers. And it was really, really great, because this guy is super enthusiastic, and he really liked the PCB and the design. But he said, this PCB could be better, because this PCB, there is electromagnetic radiation coming from it, because it's a two-layer PCB. And if you would do it better, you would make a four-layer PCB and have a ground plane. But we didn't do that. And we also had very little experience in this. But he did a series on this PCB. He also he got the original KiCad files from us, and he transformed it into a four-layer board. And he also did measurements on the electromagnetic radiation coming from that one. So that was really interesting to see what he did. Oh, and what was also funny is he didn't look at the manual at all. He just took the PCB and the components, soldered them on and it worked. And that's really when, so first stage of building this is really fun because you're learning new things. You are figuring out how everything works, and you also are doing different things like making manual, making hardware, making software, making it a kit. And then there's the hard work of filling all the bags and doing all the boring stuff. But then people start to buy it and they send you pictures of how they made it. And that's really cool. So if you have a project that you're building yourself and you think it might be interesting to make it into a kit, yeah, do so, because it's really rewarding if you get positive feedback. And I get to stand here to talk to you, so that's also nice. So you get a lot of stuff in return. But there was one thing that we got back, and that is that people said we would like to be able to get to do some programming on it. So we wanted to expand it. And one of the last things we did before we sent the first version, here you see also, by the way, that we have a version 3 of the ROM. Currently we have version 4. There are a few games here. Those games were written by people who bought the Gigatron and wrote games themselves. But the last item on the list is Loader. And that was a bit of our escape. We thought, in the future, we need to be able to put something in there without reprogramming the EEPROM. And there's only one input that we have. This is the only input that we have. And this is very rudimentary. We can only send one bit and then pull it out per screen. How do we do it? Well, the loader, what the loader does is it takes these bytes from the controller and it sees them as programming code. It puts it in RAM and then executes it. So we can use this to send, this would be hard to toggle in a program using the keys, but using the same port, we can send code in. So for that, you need an Arduino. So we made an Arduino hookup. So you can tell the Arduino to send the correct instructions onto the port. It will be loaded into the RAM and executed. And that eventually turned into this prototype. So we took an 80Tiny microprocessor. So that's actually a thing that is more powerful than the whole Gigatron. And what it can do is it can translate, use a PS2 keyboard signals into these signals. PS2 is simple enough still. USB keyboards are too complicated. PS2 is still around. People can still get PS2 keyboards, like this one. And so we made it for PS2. And this prototype has now become what we call Pluggy McPlugface. So this is also a do-it-yourself soldering thingy, very tiny circuit board with the 80Tiny and the input and the output, that's it. So this contains the software to do the translation, and you can hook it up. And now we have written BASIC. So that was a huge improvement. And it was really a very good feeling, because when we started with this computer, we thought it might drive a 9x9 LED matrix. And now we have a system actually running BASIC. And that opens up a lot of possibilities. So this version is called Tiny BASIC. It's an existing BASIC. And what we even hacked into it is that you can save a program into the 80Tiny. So if you type in the command save, well, there's only one way to get information to the controller, right? That's via H-sync and V-sync signals. Those are fixed. Well, if we change the timing of the horizontal sync by one bit, it's still okay-ish enough for most screens to not lose video. And that one bit can be captured by the processor and it can store it into the 80Tiny's memory. And then we can give a special command, so the 80Tiny will type back the program into RAM.
How much data operate?
Sorry?
What speed it operates, like 60 beats per second?
It's not fast. I will show you in the demo later. It's quite slow, and also there's only limited space. So you can write a program of 30 lines maybe, and then it's full. And then people started to do other things like a RAM expansion. This is by a user of ours. He said, I like to double the RAM. Well, you can if you like. We have a breakout for the address line that you need. You see a wire there coming over. You can put in double of the RAM and fine.
But all these changes are no open source, right?
These changes are all open source. We have a forum where everything is on. Actually, everything that you see here is open source except the contents of the manual and the keycard files or the Gerber files for the PCB. And the reason is that we are still trying to get a little bit back for our 2 years of work. And in the end, we will stop selling them and also make the Gerber's public domain. But there are actually people who have made their own PCBs and or built it on a breadboard. The schematics are online. And there was always the question, can we do more expansion? And that led to a RAM switching board. So this is a bit of an experimental status. We have a few PCBs made, and then we can translate it to SPI protocol. And with SPI, you can attach all kinds of hardware. It also acts as a RAM expansion. So what you do is you take out the existing RAM, plug this in, and you can put in the original RAM or a bigger one, and you get the extra SPI outputs to hook up whatever you like. So in this example, is this a movie? Yeah. We write some assembler code there to output two LEDs. And what you see here is an SD card, SPI SD card reader. And Marcel is the software guy. He is currently programming something that will be able to read SD cards. So that would also be a nice addition. And people have gotten all kinds of ideas. So there's one user who tried to overclock it. Of course, if you overclock it, because the clock frequency is for VGA, then your VGA doesn't work. So you can overclock to 8 MHz, but then you don't have VGA signal. The system will work, but you have no output. But this guy overclocked it exactly twice, and then you have to make small software changes, but then you can get a working system. That's about the fastest you can get without, well, I think 50 megahertz is about the limit. But then you need the fast version of these TTL chips, the F-series. There's somebody who made a very tiny version. Then there were people working on software, so somebody thought, let's have a C compiler. And they wrote a C cross compiler, but this is actually also a work in progress. There is a simple library, but you don't have many functions, so it's not like you can now easily cross compile C programs and have them run. But it's a start. But the latest edition maybe makes this obsolete, and that's that there is now a complete 6502 emulator in the Gigatron. So instead of running vCPU code, the interpreter can run 6502 code. It is a bit different from an Apple One. Oh, it says here, it should say for Apple One. It is like an Apple One because the Apple One had a 6502. So you can like run Apple One code. Although the relook, it's on a different place of memory and the I/O differs a little bit. But with minor tweaks, we can run native Apple One code on the Gigatron. And that's cool because our idea was to build a computer system with simple logic that could have existed in the time of the Apple One. So we can run Wozmon. Wozmon is the hardware monitor written by Steve Wozniak, and that was included in the original Apple One. So we can run that. We could already run that. It's in the EEPROM, but that's a rewritten version in our machine language of your CPU code. And this is native 6502 code. You can also run Microchess, which is running here. So that's Microchess. It's very rudimentary because this is 70 stuff. but it's running 6502 code. I can't even remember what the slide is about, so let's see what's happening. Ah, right. So here we are running the Wasmon, sorry, the Apple, what's it called? Disassembler, to disassemble itself. So this is a famous disassembler for which Steve Wozniak wrote a paper in the 70s. It's less than 500 bytes long, and it's a complete disassembler. So it's really cool that with this user community, really, yeah, gets the whole thing going, and people are writing software. We are trying to improve stuff, but we have this community. We build a forum. People are posting on there, doing incredible stuff. So that's very nice to see.